This is the most expensive.
I usually have a fellow by the name of Ken Hall that helps me with that ag adventure. He's a journeyman horseshoer, and he come from Scotland. And in Scotland, in the European countries, why it's a four-year education. And at the end of the 4 years, if you don't pass the test, you don't shoe horses. And it's not necessarily called a license, but it's a registry. So you have to be a registered horseshoer, but you have to go through this four-year apprentice. In this country, probably, you know, horseshoeing schools can be anywhere from 2 weeks, 3 days to, you know, they're very short in comparison.
I
just going to shoe this one foot for you, but I'm in such a habit of shoeing the left front, I just made a left front shoe. Maybe it seems quite often people they call me and they want to maybe ride with me or to learn how to shoe horses, you know. And maybe for one reason or another, I don't know, they think that maybe what I do is, when I shoe horses, that inspires in one way or another. But in some respects, what it would do for people to learn how to shoe horses kind of the way I do at this period of time, you'd kind of set them up for failure. Because it would cost them too much money, whether it was education, you know, to get set up in business. And then what you have to think about is developing a clientele or a reputation that people let you do. You know, the thing that I see happening is, boy, I'm pretty happy kind of what I do, or pleased at what I do, is because when I go shoe a horse, I don't have people tying my hands. And what I mean by that is people tie their hands because they pretty much tell you what to do. I don't know if you'd want to write this down, but I was thinking, just if you don't mind, I'll shut that off. Is a young lady the other day, she come to me and she said, my horse is sore, and the person come out and trimmed the horse. Well, what happened is she told the person to trim the horse. Now he might have been able to say, if it was my horse, I probably wouldn't trim it. But because she told him to trim the horse, he trimmed the horse. So now she was a little concerned because now her horse is sore. So just this morning when I was feeding away, I saw her again. She said, well, I had the farrier come out, I don't even know if she called him farrier. She had the person come out and put front shoes on the horse. Well, what's happening, because the people want to make the decision, it's ending up costing her more money, more aggravation. She can't shoot, you know, she's not be able to ride the horse. Like, for instance, she had the front end shot on the horse. So what happens with horses, they wear more of the hind feet out than they do the front feet. So I almost say that if a horse needs to be shod, he probably needs to be shod all the way around. And so people shoe the front, because sometimes maybe a person that shoes horses might charge less just for putting front shoes on than hind shoes. So basically what that client would be telling me is that she wants to save money some way, and she really, maybe they don't care about the horses, you know, like, and this young person knows me pretty well, like, she never asked me about any of that, you know, and I thought that's kind of strange, you know. I'd be glad to help her, you know. Yeah, I wouldn't necessarily have to do the horse, but I could give her some good information, you know. But they make the choice, and so, like, if I went to do a horse and I felt like it wasn't for the benefit of the horse, or people are tying my hands and won't let me do good work, I would just soon not do the horse, you know. That's where I get my satisfaction, I guess, or why I shoe horses. I get to do good work. I don't have that problem with, you know, horses being real difficult or people being real difficult. I try to get myself out of that realm as much as I can. And anybody in business, why, after a few years, people can call you up on the phone or meet you, and it doesn't take you very long. You get very sensitive to what people's needs and wants are, and sometimes they aren't the needs of the horse. They're personal needs. It doesn't have anything to do with their horses. So that's kind of where I'm talking about tying my hands, you know, is, it takes a certain amount of money to do a good job, that's what it takes. If it takes a little longer to do the horse, that's what I do. You know. So that's why I'm kind of happy with it. People ask me sometimes, or the notion comes up, sometimes I think people think about the foot on a horse is like a block of wood. You just chop away at it. And when I think about shoeing horses in my experience, and there isn't any point there where I would say that I know everything about a horse's foot. But what I do know is I try to use that as my advantage anyway for the horse. But if anybody would ask me, and this isn't my own, when I was teaching school, why we would have an opportunity to go visit. We'd go to Cow Palace and talk to farriers there, go to harness horse meets, I expose the students to a lot of different farriers. And over the years, I would ask some of these farriers, if you were to tell me how long does it take for a person to learn how to shoe horses and kind of get by in business, where if you lead a horse up to them, they could probably have a pretty good idea how to shoe them. Most of them would say at least 10 years. And in that 10 years, maybe you're talking about a person maybe, you know, maybe shooting close to 10,000 head of horses. So if you shoe quite a few horses and you're pretty sincere about what you're doing and have studied it, well, it'll probably take 10 years. Shoeing horses about the third year that I shod horses, and every year after that I've always thought that I just knew less and less and less. When you get to a point where you figure you feel like you know quite a bit about shoeing horses, some horse will come along and just blow you away. And some of the best horse shoers that I've ever talked to always have a story to tell about a horse they couldn't figure out how to shoot, and you'd interchange information to get some thoughts of maybe what you would do to that kind of a foot. this hot seating is probably one of the most influential things, or one of the best things you could do of shoeing a horse. And there's several reasons for it. I have that little handout I'll give you. But
it's something probably the modern day horseshoe has kind of gotten away from. And it has a lot to do with soundness in horses, is wall being the primary great grain structure. You have the foot in the shoe. You probably see less locked shoes and more sound horses that keep the hot seat.
This foot is a phenomenal engineering for instance to get when you think about a foot absorbing on a 1,000-pound horse 2.5 times its body weight. So a 1,000-pound horse might absorb as much as 25